welcome all of you to this course on Upanishads. This is one of the most important courses because it forms the whole essence of our Indian culture. Why this course? Naturally, a question comes. Upanishads are thousands of years old. We are in an age of science and technology with all modernity. Why should you look at old things? Is the question that comes. We all have several conflicts in life. Conflict between husband and wife, parents and children, and one director and another director, all types of conflicts. Another big challenge is stress and its hazards. Stress is spreading like wildfire everywhere. So, we all get lost in stress and its hazards. We become unhappy. Therefore, what is that we call as happiness? The quest for happiness. And scientists want what is reality. Is there a fundamental reality from where this whole universe has come? Finally, the meaning of this life. We all take birth and one day we are going to die. Is there a meaning to this life? Such questions arise at a very fundamental level. And this course gives you answers to such questions. That is the speciality of this course. Conflicts in life. The opening scenario of Bhagavad Gita presents a very dramatic conflict which arose in the minds of Arjuna. He came with all the determination, I am going to take part in this war, kill my opponent and win the war. He asked Krishna, please take the chariot to the forefront. And Krishna takes to the forefront. There he sees all the 100 Kaurava brothers lined up, which he expected. Then his arch friend Karna, no surprise. Then he looks here, Upacharya, Kulukuru has come. Then turns here, he sees Dronacharya, his own guru, who made Arjuna, Arjuna. Then we look at the commander, who is the commander-in-chief, Bhishma Pitamaha. And he is totally confused now. A big conflict arises in his mind. He starts thinking, should I kill all these people? My brothers, my people like Dronacharya, my guru, teacher, and the best of the people like Bhishmacharya, who are worth of worship. Katham Bhishma Maham Sankhe Dronancha Marasudana Ishupi Pratiyotsami Pujarha Parisudana. They are worth of worship. How can I kill? No Krishna, no Krishna. I can't do that. I can't do that. And he is completely confused. Arjuna starts thinking, what is the result of this war? We'll get the kingdom for what? To get all the comforts in life? And we are going to kill all these people? Yadrajya sukhalobena hantum swajanam udyataha vayam. Have we not become very selfish, greedy in killing all these people to get the comfort of this kingdom and the life? No. It is wrong. We are becoming very selfish and very short-sighted. Arjuna's thinking goes this way. Deep question, conflict arises in the minds of Arjuna. As a Kshatriya, I have to wage the war. I have to perform my duty as a Kshatriya. Another side, should I kill all my people who are worth the worship? And am I not becoming greedy in the encounter? Conflict between duty on one side, conflict between the duty and the humanitarian consideration. Should I not show love, compassion, and should I not sacrifice? He hears to the heart one side, another side the head. And his heart takes over. And tells Krishna, no Krishna, I can't kill the people. I cannot throw my arrow and inflict pain on my own teacher, Dronacharya. They are worth of worship. No, I can't do that. And he is completely confused. He cannot stand in the chariot. He just sits down and the big bow, Gandiva, starts coming down from his hand. Gandivam sransate hastat. నచ శక్నోం వ్యవస్థాతుం భ్రమతీవ చ మే మనః. అండ్ హిస్ మైండ్ ఇస్ ఫుల్ ఆఫ్ కన్ఫ్యూజన్, ఎ వెరీ డీప్ కాన్ఫ్లిక్ట్ బిట్వీన్ డ్యూటీ సైన్స్ అనదర్ ఇస్ హ్యుమానిటేరియన్ కన్సిడరేషన్ విచ్ ఇస్ బెటర్ ఆఫ్ ద టూ, బోత్ ఆర్ గుడ్. సచ్ ఇస్ ది ఓపెనింగ్ సినేరియో అండ్ ఇట్ ఇస్ ఓన్లీ హియర్ ఇన్ దిస్ కోర్స్ ఇన్ ద భగవద్గీత ఇన్ ద ఉపనిషత్స్ వీ హ్యావ్ ది ఆన్సర్స్ ఫర్ దిస్. వేదస్ ఫ్రమ్ ద నాలెడ్జ్ బేస్ ఆఫ్ ద ఈస్ట్, ద వర్డ్ వేద కమ్స్ ఫ్రమ్ ది రూట్ విద్ జ్ఞానే, దట్ మీన్స్ టు నో. వేదాస్ మీన్స్ ట్రెషర్ హౌస్ ఆఫ్ నాలెడ్జ్, ఎన్సైక్లోపీడియా ఆఫ్ ఆల్ నాలెడ్జ్ కంటైన్ ఇన్ అవర్ ఈస్టర్న్ విజ్డమ్ బేస్ అండ్ దట్ గివ్స్ యూ ద హోల్ ఎస్సెన్స్ అండ్ ఆఫర్ సొల్యూషన్స్ టు వాట్ వి డిస్కస్డ్. ఫోర్ వేదాస్, ఋగ్వేద, యజుర్వేద, సామవేద, అథర్వవేద, వి ఆర్ ఆల్ ఫెమిలియర్. బట్ దెర్ ఇస్ అనదర్ క్లాసిఫికేషన్ నోన్ ఎస్ పూర్వమీమాంస అండ్ ఉత్తరమీమాంస. పూర్వమీమాంస డీల్స్ విత్ ఆల్ రిచువల్స్, యజ్ఞాస్, హవనాస్, హోమాస్, పూజాస్ అండ్ ఆల్ దిస్ ఫారమ్ ది పూర్వమీమాంస. ఐ కాల్ దిస్ యాజ్ ద ఇండస్ట్రీ ఆఫ్ ద వేదాస్, టెక్నాలజీ ఆఫ్ ద వేదాస్, బికాస్ హియర్ యూ కెనాట్ ఆస్క్ క్వశ్చన్స్. Your priest asks you to do particular thing, you must just go on following that, doing it. You go to a marriage and the marriage priest says, do this, do this, do this, and you have to just go on doing these things. Similarly, you have completed your engineering, let us say, and you have joined an automobile industry. You are trained for 6 months intensively and you are made to work on a particular valve. So then you go to the industry, the manufacturing place, and every day you have to turn about 20 such valves for the car. And you have to follow all the checklist meticulously. There will be supervision, there will be statistical process control, there is the quality control and all that. And there you cannot ask questions, sir, why should I do like this? Why not like this? Why not like this? You can't ask questions. You know. If you want to ask questions, then you have to go to some other place. The research lab, there will answer you. Similarly, Purvamimamsa deals essentially with the rituals. You have to just follow without questioning. That is one part of the Vedas. The second part is Uttaramimamsa. I call this as the science of the Vedas. Here you have to question and question and question. If you don't question, you are not a good student. Just like in modern science. And the methodology of science and methodology of the Upanishads also are very similar. Depending on the type of questions you ask, the teacher will judge you whether you belong to primary, middle school, high school, college or PhD. You know, that is the dimension. The Upanishads, therefore, are essentially scientific in its approach. So no blind faith. Everything to be questioned and it should be experimented on, and you have to repeat the experimentation and get the result. What you call in the modern sciences multicentric trials, repeated experimentation, observations and the inference, same methodology in Upanishads. Therefore, I call Upanishads or Uttaramimamsa the science of the Vedas. Therefore, we have two parts. One, the Purvamimamsa, another Uttaramimamsa. The science and the industry. Science and its applications to the modern industry. Uttaramimamsa are contained in Upanishads. Upanishad therefore form the science of the Vedas, foundations of Indian culture in Upanishads. Essentially we have the Upanishads as directly revealed to the great seers. Therefore they are called as the Shruti Prasthana. That means when they go into deep meditation, they get the revelation which they put forth in the form of Upanishads. Therefore, it is not edited form, it is all in the revelation form. There are exclamations, they are just telling that, Avo, 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 Ahamannam, 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 such exclamations. Therefore, there is a need to put all these things in a very nice formatted way, edited way, and has to be brought forward like a thesis. That is called the Smriti Prasthana. There are a number of Smritis. Yajnavalkya Smriti, Manusmriti, and several others. Among them, Bhagavad Gita is considered to be one of the most profound among the Smritis. Smriti means retold, edited. And Bhagavad Gita, therefore, is a Smriti Prasthana, which is essentially giving the same content as in the Upanishads. Sarva Upanishadaha Sarasangraha Bhutoyam Granthaha, as Shankaracharya writes in the beginning of Bhagavad Gita. That means Bhagavad Gita gives all the things which are available in the Upanishads in the form of 18 chapters. That is the Smriti Prasthana. And then any wisdom which has to go for a long time, get established, it will be put into a mathematical foundation. And this is known as the Nyaya Prasthana. That is the Brahma Sutras. From the Nyaya Prasthana, that is the logical framework in which you present everything in the form of sutras, in the form of formulae, and they are all connected with one another, connected with one another. Therefore, we have three streams, the Shruti Prasthana, the Smriti Prasthana, and the Nyaya Prasthana. They are called as the Prasthana Traya, three streams of knowledge, which gives the whole foundation of the wisdom base. The style of the Upanishad is something very unique. It's very informal. It is in the form of questions and answers. The questions by the students and the teacher responds to it. And depending on the type of questions, the teacher will give suitable directions for the student to get the answers. In one of the Upanishads, the student comes and asks, Kuta yesha prano jayate, katham ayasmin sharire, atmanam va pravibhajya katham pratishtate, genot kramate, katham vahyam avidate, katham madhyatmam iti. And the teacher is so thrilled. You are asking the question of questions. Many people do not know there is something like prana apart from this just body. And you know that there is prana. Now we are asking whether prana is the highest or is there something beyond prana. And you are trying to understand the functioning of the prana. Fantastic, fantastic, my dear. Atiprashtan pruchasi brahmishtosi tasmateham bravimi. You are asking question of the question. You are so great. And you are like a brahmishta, I will say. Therefore, I am going to give you the answer. So saying, the teacher gives the answer. What he says, Atmana esha prano jayate. Prana is not the highest. It all comes from the pure consciousness called Atman or Brahman. Prana is the basic fabric of this entire creation. And that which is beyond creation is our original state. You may call it as Paramatman, you may call it as Parabrahman or pure consciousness. It is a state beyond space, time, causation, which is unchanging reality. And therefore you have to transcend the prana to reach that state. That is how the teacher directs the students to get an answer. Just as in modern science, the professor asks the student to go to the laboratory and investigate himself. Similarly, in the Upanishads, the teacher directs the students to go and do the experiment by himself. And in the process of experimentation, he goes to deeper and deeper steps. For example, in science, the professor says hydrogen and oxygen brings water, H2O. He is asked to go to the lab. So the student goes to the laboratory, brings hydrogen, oxygen, puts them together. He doesn't get any water. He comes back to the professor, say, "Hey, you have said it's wrong. How can two gas bring water through it? I don't believe in that." A very critical student. Then the professor says, "How much of hydrogen, how much of oxygen did you take? H2O, did you do that?" "Oh, I forgot that." Then he goes back, measures how much of hydrogen is there, how much of oxygen is there, the whole science of measurement he learns. Then he puts them together, still he doesn't get water. Again comes back to the professor. And professor says, "How did you put them together? You have to not mechanically mix them. You have to put them electrolytically." "Oh, what is electronics? What is electricity? What is voltage?" All that he learns, and he puts the electrode, puts them together, then hydrogen and oxygen, then he gets a drop of water. So thrilled he is. This is experimentation. Same methodology in Upanishads. A student comes and asks, "Sir, I want to know about Brahman." "No." And the teacher says, "Oh, you want to know Brahman? Go and do tapas. Tapasa brahma vijignasasva tapo brahmeti." "What is tapas? How to do the experiment?" He looks at him. Teacher understands. "Oh, how to do the tapas you are asking, no? I will tell you." He gives the hint. "There is something within you because of which you are born. And it's the same thing that keeps you alive. And when you die, you go back to the same thing. Find out what that is." "Yato va imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prayanti abhisambhishanti iti tad vijignasasva tad brahmeti." He says. Oh, he gets a hint. This is how he will conduct the experiment. And go step by step, to go to the deeper and deeper levels until he gets the complete reality. So this is the modality of Upanishads, which is very much akin to modern science. Therefore, the teacher will make the students to investigate by themselves, to find the answers by themselves. Therefore, it is extremely experimental in nature and not just blind faith. That is the beauty of the Upanishad. That's why I call Upanishads as the science of the Vedas. The teacher is something very special. He continues to learn and learn and learn. He has an aspiration to learn more. He doesn't stop learning because he knows perfection has no limits. One of the students comes, he's a great emperor. He asks the teacher, "Sir, I've heard that there is a 16-dimensioned Purusha. I want to know who is that." "Shodashakala Purusham Bharadvaja Vetha," he asks. The teacher is Bharadvaja. He looks at him. "What? 16-dimensioned Purusha? I have not heard that. I do not know about that. But I am also interested to learn that. Come on, let both of us go to our great master Pipalada." And both of them go to the great Maharishi Pipalada to understand what is that 16-dimensional Purusha that have been talked about. This is the type of aspiration a teacher has in teaching the students. It's a great lesson to all of us as teachers. You are going to become instructors, teachers. You must have that aspiration to continuously learn more and more, more and more, and get at the depth and to greater, greater heights. That is the beauty of the Upanishads. The teacher should have the aspiration to learn more You never think that I have learned everything. There is nothing else to learn, because there's infinite things to learn.